And we now move on to questions to the Minister for Employment and Learning. And I call, if that's right, Thomas Buchanan is not in his place. I call Karen McKevitt.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Question two.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Widening participation in further and higher education to students from a disadvantaged background is a key strategic aim for my department. As the main providers of adult education throughout Northern Ireland, colleges continue to encourage access to further education, including performing arts, by delivering a varied curriculum through their campuses and community outreach centres. Colleges have a strong track record in attracting enrolments from deprived areas. In the 2013-14 academic year, there were over 1,000 enrolments in performing arts courses in further education. Of this, 21% were from the most deprived areas. Performing arts courses were available from level 1 to level 5 and offered learners the opportunity to acquire the skills and knowledge they need to gain qualifications to help them to progress in their chosen careers. A range of financial assistance to students with low incomes is also available.
I call Karen McKevitt for supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister, has the variety of such arts courses taught in this region increased in line with any so-called Game of Thrones effect, given that we have benefited so much from the like of the film industry here in the North?
Well, first of all, the Member is right to point to the benefits to our economy that are coming from the film and other creative industries being present within our economy. And indeed, the further education system itself is there to be something that is very responsive to the needs of the local business community and also investors coming in. It's important to bear in mind that while the question itself is around performing arts, it is part of a much wider landscape that involves a whole range of creative industries, and that includes through from textiles, fashion, through to multimedia, the different other aspects that are important in terms of film production, such as sound as well. So our colleges are providing courses in the full spectrum of the different areas that make up the creative industries, including the performing arts, and that way we are bringing forward a range of people with the relevant skills. It's also important to recognise as well that we are continuing to invest in the further education estate to ensure that we have modern world-class facilities, to ensure that we are providing the best type of environment for our students to pick up the skills that are so important to those fast-growing industries.
I call Leslie Cree.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I would ask the Minister, what support has been given to FE colleges so they can deliver courses and supplement the good work that's been done, the film and television industry minister has mentioned, so in fact that can encourage more people to be involved in that?
Well, thank the member for the question. It's difficult to say that we're in a position to give more support because, as the House will be very much aware, we're going through a situation of very difficult financial cuts, and indeed that the FE sector is bearing an element of those. So we are working with the colleges to ensure that we try to minimise the impact of those cuts on the front line and also those areas that are most relevant to the economy. And obviously the type of areas that are touched upon by the questions to date will fall into those areas that are very relevant. We are also, as I said as well, continuing to invest in the capital estate, and as the member represents North Down, he'll be very much conscious of the imminent opening of the space at Cirque's campus in Bangor, which will also be a very major asset to the whole community in Northern Ireland in this regard.
I call Claire Sugden.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Is the Minister aware of the financial aspect of the business case not to continue dance and drama classes at Belfast Metropolitan College?
Well, it's not an issue in terms of a business case as such. These are decisions to be taken by the colleges themselves, who are there to manage their resources. And obviously all of our colleges are facing some very difficult circumstances and are needing to make difficult decisions. It's important as well that we bear in mind our colleges are not simply there to service a distinct geographical area. It's important that we encourage specialism across our colleges, and we also encourage collaboration across our colleges. It's also worth bearing in mind that the very particular direction travel that is happening in Belfast Met isn't just a product of the current financial climate, though that obviously has accelerated the approach that's been taken. But there is a strategic direction to this, which was set out in the College Development Plan, which actually predates my time as Minister.
Moving on, I call Cathal O'Hashin.
At
present, the majority of postgraduate students from Northern Ireland must finance their own studies. Within the minority who are funded, some are, for student support purposes, treated as undergraduates. My department also funds a postgraduate awards scheme, which is providing over 700 scholarships this academic year. These scholarships cover students', students' approved tuition fees and provide around £14,000 per annum to support them with their living costs. But they are limited in number and largely restricted to PhD students and are allocated by our universities on a highly competitive basis. There is no standard student finance package in place for postgraduate students through the Student Loans Company. Looking ahead, it is clear that our economic growth is going to be highly and increasingly dependent on higher skill levels. And these skill demands will only intensify under a potentially lower rate of corporation tax. Indeed, forecasting commissioned by my department has shown that under a lower corporation tax environment, the requirement for postgraduate qualifications in our workplace will rise faster than any other qualification type. However, Northern Ireland continues to enrol far fewer postgraduate students relative to our population than any other country in the UK. Supporting an increase in postgraduate provision is therefore not only a matter of social justice, it is an economic imperative. That is why 2 weeks ago I launched a policy consultation which considers a range of options for better assisting postgraduate students through the student finance system. The consultation will run until the 11th of September, and my department will publish a summary of responses after that date. Any new policies resulting from the consultation will carry significant lead-in times for a range of legislative and administrative reasons.
I call Cathal O'Hashin.
I thank the Minister for his answer, and I commend him for launching the consultation. But can he tell us how important increasing access to postgraduate degrees is to the wider economy?
First of all, I can thank the member for his comments and welcome for the consultation, which also, I should mention, covers potential options for supporting part-time students as well. But on the issue of postgraduate students, as our economy evolves ever further, the demand for higher level skills will increase, and that includes beyond primary degree level to level 7 and 8. So it's important that we ensure that we have a proper investment in that regard, and that will accelerate in the context of a lower level of corporation tax. The dilemma at present is that we do have a system of support which does tend to help those who are doing PhDs, but not those who are doing masters. We see the same situation occurring elsewhere in the UK, and a lot of people talk about the broken bridge between an undergraduate through a master's then progressing to a PhD. And that's why, in particular, the consultation focuses around what we can do to better assist master's students, and that's where I think the greatest efficiency has been identified, not just in Northern Ireland but elsewhere in these islands.
Call Sean Rogers.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And Minister, thanks for that detailed answer. You did mention the economic imperative there. Would it be the preferred option of the Department that any such schemes would target those subject areas identified as key economic drivers?
Well, we certainly can focus the scheme around some particular subject areas. Cost implications may drive us in that particular direction, but also some of the options in the consultation are across the board, and recognise that there may well be interest in studying a range of subjects. The critical aspect as to whether this is going to actually work or not work, bearing in mind that we are going through times of major financial stress, is whether we can access a system of loans from the Treasury. So in essence, that the system will become almost a self-funding system, provided that repayments are made within the approved range that the Treasury scheme will allow. The member may be aware that for England, the UK Chancellor of the Exchequer has announced the development of a loan scheme. That now opens up the opportunity for us in Northern Ireland to have a similar scheme for our own jurisdiction. So that's hopefully the path that we're going to pursue. And if that does fall in place, then we may be able to extend the intervention beyond those subjects that are most relevant to the economy, but to a wider range of areas too.
I call Anna Lowe.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Nowadays, many workers prefer to do their master's degrees part-time. What plans are there from Dell to support those students?
Well, thank the member for the question. Any scheme has to be one that can adapt to those who are both full-time students and also part-time students. And it's also worth stressing, as well as I did to Mr. O'Washing, that we are seeking to also look at options to support part-time students at an undergraduate level. Undergraduate part-time study is an area where, again, there is significant scope for expansion. And in particular, as we seek to encourage people to study at higher skill levels from a range of different backgrounds beyond the conventional 18 to 21 year bracket, which in itself is probably something that's no longer something that's seen as being the exclusive source of students. And we seek to develop a wider range of students studying. And also, as we recognise that we're under pressure in terms of how we can fund full-time places, The importance of part-time study takes on an even greater presence in terms of the way that we will be engaging in skills. It's also important that as we look to link up our higher education system with the emerging strategy on apprenticeships, that we look to funding mechanisms that will support students who are within an apprenticeship system, but who are also then accessing their off-the-job training through university, and by definition they will be part-time students. So this funding model itself may well be important in that regard, as well as those students who are doing part-time study on a freestanding basis.
Moving on, I call George Robinson.
Question 4, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
With a very smooth link, we launched Securing Our Success, the Northern Ireland Strategy on Apprenticeships in June 2014, which committed to putting employers at the heart of a new apprenticeship system. Naturally, the success of the system will be reliant on successful engagement with employers, in particular those from small and micro-businesses, which are the backbone of the Northern Ireland economy. That's why the apprenticeship strategy recognises the need for tailored support for such businesses. A key aspect of supporting business will be through the proposed apprenticeship central service, which will signpost employers, particularly small and micro businesses, to appropriate sources of advice and guidance, as well as administering any support and incentives which might be made available. This will be tested from the autumn of 2015 with a view to introduction of a new central service by September 2016. Last year, I established an interim strategic advisory forum comprised of employers, trade unions, providers of off-the-job training and other key stakeholders to provide advice on key issues concerning implementation of the new strategy. A subgroup of this body has been established to look specifically at ways to support small and micro employers to engage with the new system. The subgroup has met on a number of occasions to examine a range of measures, including financial incentives, group training approaches and wider administrative support that could be introduced to support small and micro employers to engage with the new system. The subgroup will develop proposals and test these with a wider range of employers before presenting recommendations to me in the autumn.
I call George Robinson for supplementary.
Thank the Minister for his answer. And would the Minister agree that small and micro businesses play a vital role for the economic and employment development of Northern Ireland in the short to medium future?
Yes, I very much concur with that sentiment. And it's also worth bearing in mind that in terms of the structure of our economy, we have a greater predominance of smaller micro-businesses than many other societies. And indeed, what is viewed as an SME in Northern Ireland is probably of a different nature in terms of scale than would be the case in other jurisdictions. So we have more smaller SMEs relative to some other countries in the world. Whenever we're talking about apprenticeships, it's important to bear in mind that there will always be a differential take-up of those opportunities subject to the size of businesses that we're talking about. What I mean by that, and larger businesses are always more readily placed to create such opportunities. This is the pattern even in the most successful vocational training systems in the world, including the Germanic countries and in Scandinavia. That's why we're putting such focus on particular types of intervention to encourage SMEs in Northern Ireland to engage with the system, because they will benefit very, very much from that type of approach to training. But in particular, our discussions so far indicate that the perhaps the biggest perceived blockages around administration and bureaucracy, and that's where I think where a lot of the focus is going to go in terms of trying to ensure that we have the full participation from that sector of the economy.
I call Fergal McKinney.
And the SDLP, and can I thank the Minister, the SDLP sees the apprenticeship model as being a strong tool for freeing up the issues around long-term unemployment. But what steps can be taken to ensure that any such apprenticeships will lead to longer-term employment for students and not lead to a situation, for example, where we have a conveyor belt of reduced-cost labour?
Well, I think it's worth saying a couple of things. First of all, just to welcome the support from the member for apprenticeships. I think there is a strong consensus across the House in terms of the importance of apprenticeships as a way forward. And I think to answer the question, it is very much in the self-interest of employers to ensure that this model is sustainable. This isn't for employers, or shouldn't be for employers, but a source of cheap labour. This is the means by which companies and organisations will find their future talent, and they will be investing in their future talent. So there is always an investment that employers have to make. They will receive a return in terms of productivity on the far side of an apprenticeship. So it's important that employers understand that this is something that actually benefits them. So if they understand that, then they won't be simply just letting people go on the far side. The second thing to stress in Northern Ireland is that we, from the outset, have been very clear around the importance of quality and not simply badging anything that looks like training in an employment context as an apprenticeship. And members will be aware that there has been a change of approach in England, notably over the past number of weeks, where there greater care is being taken about actually labelling certain types of activity as apprenticeship and avoiding labelling other types of activity as an apprenticeship. That way, if we have a focus on quality, then we'll be ensuring that those young people who are going through apprenticeships will be well served, and also the companies that benefit from apprenticeships will also be well served.
Alistair Ross is not in his place. John McAllister is not in his place. I called Barry Mickleduff.
I am in my place.
Okay.
Question number 7, Keish Divrashacht.
I am committed to improving cross-border student mobility. As part of my department's higher education strategy, a project group which includes representation from the Irish Higher Education Authority and the Institutes of Technology has been established to take this issue forward. The project team has considered the recommendations of the IBEX CBI report on undergraduate mobility and has made progress in a number of areas. In relation to improving information, careers teachers and careers advisors have received additional training on the higher education opportunities available in the South and on the Central Applications Office processes. Extensive information regarding Northern Ireland's higher education sector is now available through the NI Direct portal. As well as supporting our local students, this information can act as a gateway for other students, including those from the South, who may be interested in studying in Northern Ireland. Northern Ireland students studying in the South now have access to funding support. The Irish Universities Association recently announced that it is planning to make changes to the Central Admissions Office point system to improve access for A-level students. My officials have been working with officials in the Department of Education and Skills to research and analyse the impact of future demographics on cross-border student flows in order to inform future policy development. A joint report was published on the 15th of June. I regularly meet with the Irish Minister of Education to discuss a range of issues, including student mobility, and I will continue to meet with Minister O'Sullivan in the future to discuss progress on these issues. And my officials will work closely with their counterparts in the South on this and other cross-border issues.
I call Barry Mickleduff for supplementary.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Can I commend the Minister and the Minister of Education for work done in this area in respect of a lot of meetings with Minister Quinn and subsequently Minister O'Sullivan? But could I ask the Minister if he's satisfied that part of the training for careers teachers and careers advisors, that it is touching on the range and type of courses that are available to local students along the border corridor in the likes of Sligo IT, Letterkenny Institute of Technology, and also Dundalk IT?
Yeah, I thank the member for his question and his comments. And in some respects, he's right to focus on the careers aspect, because I'd like to think that in terms of the recommendations that we have addressed very clearly the issues around funding and the distortions that previously existed in terms of funding. The issue now with recognition of the qualifications from Northern Ireland is well on the way to being resolved, and we'll see how that rolls out over the forthcoming years. I think the key attitude now has to be around tackling attitudes and hearts and minds. Obviously, our careers teachers and careers advisors have a critical role to play in that regard. There has been a lot of training being provided, and people are much more clearly aware of the mutual opportunities that exist across the two different jurisdictions. We probably need a stronger public debate to encourage students, and that includes other influencers such as parents and friends, to think about the opportunities that may exist. Also, the member is right to indicate that as pressure on public finances continue, there will be a need for, in some areas, a degree of specialism, whether that's in terms of our universities or whether it's in terms of Institute of Technology or in terms of further education. We should be seeking to establish where we can find some economies of scale in some very particular specialisms, and indeed that we try to find solutions that are to everyone's benefit. And in some ways, we're doing that as well in terms of the research offer across our different higher education institutions on the island as well.
I call it Alban McGuinness.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his very detailed answer. Is there anything further that can be done in relation to the free movement of university students and North and South, and of course A-level and Leaving Cert students, both-way traffic? It seems to me that it's an absurd situation where we've got all these obstacles. Is there anything further, and surely the goal must be free movement of students North and South?
Well, I thank the member for his interest, and I would say that I think we have been progressively removing those actual barriers to the free movement on the island. But that said, we have seen indeed a reversal of trends perhaps over the past 10 years in terms of the scale of movement in both directions on the island, which is disappointing. And it is worth stressing that the degree of flows on the island, again in both directions, are much smaller than the flows would be between Northern Ireland and other parts of the UK. So there is undoubtedly untapped potential in that regard. And in common with what I said to Mr. McElduff, I think the real focus has to be around that of attitudes and using the careers approach, but also other key influencers in society to really encourage young people to see the full range of opportunities that are out there. The one thing I would say, of course, like any young person who wants to study outside of Northern Ireland, by all means, pursue your dreams in that regard, but don't forget us in Northern Ireland, and please consider coming back to build your career here.
I call Jim Allister.
The Minister may not have the figures to hand, but will he undertake to provide the figure of the cost to his hard-pressed budget of providing free education within our regional colleges to students from the Irish Republic? Can he provide that figure?
Well, the figure is in the region of between £6 and £7 million at present, but I will write to the member and give him the very precise figure in that regard. As the member will, of course, be aware, that this is an outworking of the European Union and the free movement of students. And just in case the House thinks all of a sudden I'm being converted to Euroscepticism, it is obviously one small source of frustration in what is otherwise a very lucrative and area where Northern Ireland massively benefits in terms of our economy and wider society. The real source of the cost that is being borne in Northern Ireland is less through the fact we have students from the south coming to study in the north. It is more the case that we don't see the flow going in the other direction. And there is a real challenge for the southern government to work on better improving the offer that they have, particularly around the level 2, level 3 equivalent in the northwest, particularly in North County Donegal. And by far, the predominance in terms of the student flows from south to north occurs in that North Donegal into Derry corridor, which does indicate that there is a recognition that Derry in some ways has been a natural hinterland over history for that part of the island, but also B, that there's a real underinvestment in terms of facilities outside the context of what is offered by Letterkenny Institute in that particular part of the island.
Moving on, I call Patsy McLaughlin.
Kermagod Laskan Kolya Kesht, Everhach, question number 8.
The consultation on the review of youth training closed in February 2015. When operational, the new youth training system will secure a step change in professional and technical training for all young people aged between 16 and 24 through a new system of learning. It will be accessible to those already in employment, those starting a new job, and those not yet in employment. The review is presently being finalised, and the strategy, when published, will include details of the new system along with an implementation plan. There will be piloting of the strategy from July of this year onwards, including the industry consultants, with the full system being in place from September
2016. I
call Patsy McLaughlin for supplementary. Thanks to the Minister for his response. Could the Minister just clarify for me how the strategy will in fact be directed at those most in need, those people not in employment, education or training?
Thank the member for his question, and maybe congratulate him on his timing, and that he's maybe just got in about a week ahead of the formal announcement of the new system, and I hope to make a statement to the Assembly next Tuesday in that regard. Our new system will be open to all young people between 16 and 24 who are capable of achieving a level 2 qualification. There is a pool of people who are, for different reasons, leaving school, not progressing directly into further education or higher education, into apprenticeships or into employment, but clearly have the potential with support to do so. And the new system is designed to be of assistance to them. Where people are not yet in the position in terms of a level 1 qualification to access the new system of youth training itself, there will be a range of support available to help people to get that far, and that will include a lot of the projects that have been announced and that will be resourced under the European Social Fund.
I call Phil Flanagan.
With the last concurrent request, ever an E, question number 9.
At present, full-time undergraduate higher education students from Northern Ireland receive their maintenance support payments in 3 instalments, roughly at the beginning of each term of the academic year. A number of student union bodies and also a number of fellow members of the Assembly have raised concerns in recent months about this existing payment frequency. It is felt that larger and less frequent payments heighten the risk of financial mismanagement and, by extension, the risk of financial hardship among students. It has been suggested that smaller and more frequent payments would better prepare students for entering the working world, where wages are, in the majority of cases, paid monthly. Of course, there are other sides to the argument as well. Students contend not only with day-to-day living costs, but in many cases with significant upfront costs in respect of things such as accommodation, books and equipment. Therefore, I do intend to launch a consultation in the near future outlining a range of options for the frequency at which these payments are made, including options for monthly payments. The consultation will clearly outline the pros and cons of each option and also any additional administrative costs associated with the options considered. I would stress that the consultation will only consider the frequency at which the existing maintenance package is paid. In our current financial circumstances, it would simply not be realistic to consider options for raising the level of overall support available. The consultation is currently under development by my officials, and I hope to have the opportunity to consider the initial draft in the near future.
Call Phil Flanagan for supplementary.
I get the last control who's going Bukas Leshen Iris up to Aragra. Thank the Minister for his answer. And I hope that in the round that this will be seen as a positive move for students. But can I ask him to? He says there's no money. excuse me. There's no money to increase the maintenance payments the students get, even though tuition fees are going up in line with inflation. Does he not see it a bit unfair that his department continues to increase tuition fees, often above the rate of inflation, but there's no reciprocal increase in the maintenance fees or the maintenance support grants given to students to cover those costs?
Well, what I would say to the member, I would love it to be. different, and things have been going so well so far today, and we've been keeping ourselves reasonably calm and focused on the detail around policy. But I have to mention the elephant in the room, that unless we have a major change in terms of the nature of funding for higher education in Northern Ireland, then options such as the increased funding of maintenance support aren't simply going to be viable. So while the member may well make a powerful case in that regard, in the context where the higher education sector alone is facing in-year cuts to date of £16 million, on top of what is already a structural deficit, according to universities, of around £39 million, with other pressures, including from the members' colleagues for expansion of the sector, notably at the McGee campus in Derry, we are in a very difficult position to proceed along the lines the member articulates.
And that is the end of our time for listed questions, and we now move on to topical questions. And I call Sean Lynch.
The Minister recently held a conference in Belfast, Transatlantic Technology. Can he give us an indication as to the outcomes of the conference and what positive benefits it had for the local economy?
Well, I was very pleased that our colleges in Northern Ireland were able to host the TA3 conference in Belfast earlier on this month. This is a very prestigious conference which brings together practitioners in terms of the best practice around further education and vocational training from a number of different parts of the world, including the United States, Denmark, with people from Spain, from Germany, and also representation from some of the biggest employers who use vocational training, such as Siemens. The conference itself builds upon what has been a very strong track record locally of learning from best practice internationally around the successes of vocational training, and the conference provided a very good opportunity to further share that best practice. On the back of that as well, I had the opportunity to visit the Basque region in Spain in the same week, and was able to sign a memorandum of understanding with the regional government there in relation to exchange opportunities for our own local students, and also to allow our own colleges to further develop their own international strategies around learning further the best practice in terms of each other's jurisdictions. And I was encouraged that they were actually as keen to learn from us as we are to learn from them.
I call Sean Lynch for supplementary.
I want to thank the Minister for his answer, and he has possibly answered what I was going to ask him, what was learned from the international input into the conference. And I know that you mentioned a number of international companies and et cetera that was there.
Well, just to add further to that, I hope that the member will see, in terms of the ongoing policy development work of the department, and indeed at a more localised level, how this filtered through in terms of the curriculum offered by the colleges, including South West College in his own area, the outworkings of the conference itself in terms of lessons learned.
Number 2 and 8 have been withdrawn, so I call Fergal McKinney.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister, and can I ask him to what extent life and health science degrees are being impacted in the university degree cuts coming up?
Well, as the member will appreciate, both Queen's University and Ulster University have announced, in very general terms, the impact of the in-year cuts in terms of both student places and also potential staff reductions. Obviously, this is a very detrimental state of affairs, and one that is sending out a very negative image to the rest of the world, as well as impacting on opportunities for our young people. Within that framework, I have asked the universities to, insofar as they can, to protect what we term as narrow STEM subjects. The narrow STEM subjects would be maths, physics, computer science, engineering, and elements of life sciences, biological sciences. Whenever the member refers to health and life sciences, that probably is a slightly broader concept that would bring in a number of what you would term the allied health areas as well. So that requested protection, which universities are intent in delivering, wouldn't necessarily cover the full range of what the member has outlined. What I would also stress as well is that whenever we ask the universities to try to protect those subjects that are deemed to be most relevant to the economy, that comes at an additional cost. Those subjects, on average, are more expensive to provide than some of the arts and humanities courses. So whenever we ask for protection in that regard, that puts even further pressure on places elsewhere in the system. But we have to take a balanced view of what is most important in terms of the future of the Northern Ireland economy and act strategically, including at times of great pressure and stress. And all I would say is that the sooner we can have a change of direction in terms of our finances and begin to reinvest in our universities, then it will be on a much better course.
Call Fergal McKinney.
Speaker, and in his answer, the Minister has reflected part of my concern, which would be, of course, around making sure that degree courses relevant to the future economy would in fact go ahead. But in a written question and in this question, the Minister is indicating that fundamentally, despite his advice or encouragement,
and can we have a question?
It's up to the universities to make a decision. Given the importance of those science degrees and the expansion potentially of the Cancer Centre in South Belfast, which could bring very well-paid jobs, could the Minister indicate that he would put further pressure on the universities to look more favourably on those type of degrees that could lead to those better-paid jobs?
I'm a little reluctant to use the term pressure because I think we need to be slightly sensitive whenever we're part of a system overall collectively that is, in a sense, undermining what the universities have to offer already. But that said, I think it is fair to say the universities and the department share in common a sense of strategic direction. And even outside the context of how best to mitigate the effect of cuts, as part of our existing higher education strategy, there has been a project that is about rebalancing the offer within our universities. And this is not to diminish the importance of a whole range of other subjects, but it's about, on the margins, changing the balance so that we have a greater footprint in terms of those STEM subjects. And while Northern Ireland as a whole has a strong record in terms of its existing footprint in terms of STEM relative to other jurisdictions, whenever we look at the more narrow STEM subjects, we have maybe a smaller footprint in relative terms than some of our competitors. So we have already been aware of that particular imbalance and encouraging the universities to seek to address it even before we actually hit the current round of cuts.
I call Declan McAleer.
Could the Minister clarify whether or not his department has received instruction from DFP to cease the funding of non-contracted services?
Well, we have received a letter from the Finance Minister, which has requested departments to be very cautious around further discretionary spend. And I have to say, I fully understand why that letter has been issued by the Minister, because we do not have certainty as to where our budgets are going to be over the remainder of this year. And while we may see a budget agreed by the Assembly over the coming days, that in itself isn't resolving the underlying financial issues, including on an in-year basis, where in the non-implementation of Stormont House and welfare reform, there's a pressure of 600 million. And as we stand today, I have no certainty as to where my budget is going to be in several months' time and whether we are going to be asked to make further in-year cuts or not. And that actually does handcuff ministers who are acting in a responsible manner, because the more discretionary spend that a minister commits themselves to at this stage, their scope for finding savings later on in the year will be further constrained. And even in a general sense, the later you leave the any desire to find savings, the more difficult it becomes, because more and more expenditure is committed. Even to look at things like colleges and universities, they will be locked into providing places come August, September of this year. The member does touch upon the pitfalls in terms of where we stand, not just in terms of the general sense that they've been well articulated, but in terms of the day-to-day basis as to how departments manage their own expenditure.
I call Declan McAleer for supplementary.
Does the Minister accept that this move could have a particularly detrimental impact on local community and voluntary groups particularly in light of the changes to the ESF?
Well, what I would say to the member is that the attitude of his party, and indeed other parties in this chamber, are taking to the budget is having a massively detrimental impact on the community and voluntary sector, and indeed large aspects of society as a whole. We do not have a sustainable budget settlement at present for Northern Ireland. We are in an extremely bad and an extremely irresponsible place. A lot of very difficult decisions are having to be made in terms of how to manage resources given the uncertainty. And frankly, the sooner that the Members' Party come to their senses around budgets, delivery of Stormont House, implementation of welfare, including all the modalities, then the sooner we will be able to give certainty to the community and voluntary sector as to where they stand. Indeed, after I leave question time today, I'm actually meeting the disability sector to discuss the challenges that are being faced. And I'd like to think I could give them some good news from the developments in the political context today, but I suspect that we're not yet at that stage, if indeed we are going to be in that stage over the coming weeks and months.
I call Paula Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And can I first of all apologise to the Minister? I was talking to his party colleague when I should have been listening earlier, because my question is also on the issue of STEM, and it seems to be today is the day for discussion of STEM. But mine is more to do with our further education colleges and the people that I represent in my area, some of whom would be lower attainment levels, but are still interested in those subjects. So it's just to ask if there's anything that is being done within our further education colleges, and women also as well.
Can I remind members to speak into the microphone in order that everyone can hear them clearly? Thank you.
Well, thank the member for her question. I'm sure her distraction was entirely caused by my colleague as opposed to her initiating discussions, given that my colleague's sitting over there at the time. I think the member raises a couple of important points. First of all, whenever we talk about STEM, this isn't solely an issue in terms of our higher education provision. It's also what is offered in terms of further education, in terms of mainstream provision, also increasingly through the apprenticeship system as well. While obviously the FE sector is wrestling with very difficult financial challenges at present in common with other parts of the public sector, they are also trying to act in a very strategic way about seeking to protect what is most relevant to the economy. That ensures bringing people through the whole range of skill interventions around STEM. The member is also right to point to the importance of gender issues in STEM. And obviously, this has been in the news over the past number of weeks due to some ill-judged comments that have been made by a particular academic. I think we do need to always to be looking to encourage more and more women to engage in STEM careers and to study STEM in STEM areas. And unless we do that, we're not going to be fully maximising the talent base in Northern Ireland and what are the sectors that are most relevant to growing our economy.
I call Paula Bradley for supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answers. The Minister would be aware of the recent announcement at Global Point in Utnabi of the RLC, and it's just if he could outline, is he working with them at all to look at the advancement of us getting more people at all levels in STEM subjects to grow that and to produce more workers for that business?
We'll say two things. Obviously, from a departmental level, we're very keen to work with all businesses around both the careers piece, around encouraging more and more people to consider studying the relevant subjects and then moving into jobs in those sectors, and also then addressing the very particular skill requirements that they have. Also, Northern Regional College is there as a major asset, and as the member will know, they have a very particular specialism around engineering. It goes to the point I made earlier on, that different parts of Northern Ireland, there will be different emphasis placed, given the different balance of the economy in different parts of the region, and obviously NRC, given the concentration of companies, does have that reputation with respect to engineering.
I call Phil Flanagan.
Can I ask the Minister how he intends to deliver increased investment for our further and higher education sector without punishing students through increased tuition fees or without punishing welfare claimants through cuts to welfare benefits?
Oh, I suspect the members about to walk into this one. the answer again lies in the fact that we don't have political consensus over delivery of Stormont Castle, Stormont House, welfare reform. And until we do that, we are going to have a situation where we are de-investing in higher education and further education, where we will be denying opportunities to students, both in terms of their ability to finance their studies and also the opportunity to go to college or university in the first place. We will see an impact in terms of people's lives. And we hear all this talk about the importance of protecting those who are most vulnerable in society. But there are a whole host of ways we support and help those who are most vulnerable. And one of the key areas is actually giving them the ladder to escape poverty and deprivation. And one of the best ways out of poverty and deprivation is through education. That applies to investing in early years education as much as it applies to the provision of further education, higher education, training and employment opportunities. So I would suggest that if the member has that aspiration, that the solution lies with his own party and others to provide leadership around these challenging issues.
I call Phil Flanagan.
I'll ask concurrent. I suppose that the problem with the question is that you might get an answer. But if the minister really thinks that the problem to the executive's financial crisis is merely to implement welfare cuts, then you're more naive than I thought you were, because our financial crisis is much bigger.
Could we have a question,
that.
Please?
Yeah. Does the minister accept that the financial situation we're currently facing is not solely as a result of the disagreement over the cuts to the welfare system, but it's actually much bigger than that, and it's due to the cuts that have been imposed on the executive from the British government, and that's where the emphasis needs to go?
Well, there are probably three elements to why we're in this particular difficulty. First of all, we have the situation with the cuts to the block grant from the UK government. But it is what it is. The Conservative Party have been elected for better or worse in my opinion, but they're there, and they'll be there for the next 5 years. So that's the reality that we have to deal with in terms of where we get our money, because we don't have the tax base to do anything differently in Northern Ireland. And frankly, what we're doing around current budget cuts is actually setting us further back in terms of becoming self-sustaining as an economy rather than actually helping the situation. We also have structural difficulties in our budgets around the cost of division, which the Members' Party aren't particularly minded to address. And thirdly, we have the deadlock around Stormont House and around welfare. What we have in Northern Ireland is a deal around welfare. What we had was a deal around welfare that actually provided a degree of protection for our local citizens above and beyond what is on offer elsewhere in the UK. The choice is not between some idolised version of welfare that we can't afford and what's currently on the table. The choice is between what was negotiated in Stormont Castle and the full-blown version coming from London, either directly imposed over our heads or through some sort of version of direct rule. I, for one, want to avoid a situation where we are simply being handed the Tory cuts on a plate, but I'm afraid that the approach that the Members' Party is taking is actually inevitably leading to a situation where that will be the case.
And that is the end of our time for questions to the Minister. And we now